I'm really happy that we're able to have Robert Berry III. There are lots of Robert Berrys around.
There are.
But Google him, we will understand why he has all of his name and its full glory.
And there's another Robert Q. Berry.
Is he a third too?
So he needs to maintain his identity in this whole thing. So Robert is the president-elect of the National Council of Teachers of Mathematics. He will assume presidency at the annual meeting in Washington, D.C. in April of 2018, and will serve for a two-year term, and will provide the leadership and the direction for the council in that span of time. So he's agreed to talk with us. Tomorrow he's going to do kind of a formal presentation, but he's talking today to you guys about some NCTM things, some roles that you can play, wants to do a Q&A, so I'm just going to turn it over to Robert.
All right. I guess you guys can hear me then, right? But
yeah.
I guess I need to find a spot where I can just kind of move around. So I hope you guys don't mind me moving around, because I am going to move around. And no, I'm a Southern boy. So what that means is, let's treat you like family. So we're all family, right?
Yes.
All right, good. So if any of my Southern tone comes forward, that's who I am. So what I want to talk with you today about, let me tell you a little bit about me. I'm a professor at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville, Virginia, in mathematics education. I'm a former middle school math teacher. Actually, you know, I had the fortune of working in a K-8 school for a little bit of time, where I looped with a group of kids. And that was great. It was a great experience. Now I'm married to a high school math teacher, so that's always interesting as well. She often reminds me that she was an NCTM member before I was. So I get to tell her I became president before you did. But nonetheless, my wife and I, NCTM has been a significant part of our professional lives, as well as, a part of our the work that we do. At the University of Virginia, I teach. I have a very unique, interesting position. I'm middle school secondary trained, but I teach an elementary and special education program. And I also teach a math specialist program. Now, math specialist program is a K-12 program. And so I teach courses in those programs. And I also have a courtesy appointment in the mathematics department, where I teach a course called The Shape of Space. This is a geometry course, Euclidean geometry. But it is a very interesting course where we kind of bring in some kind of so, and there are non-Euclidean aspects of the course as well. Now, suppose if space is infinite, and we put in all these questions and kind of philosophize a little bit. But most of my research is focused on equity issues in mathematics education. Particularly, I focus on, for my dissertation work, I focus on black boys who have been successful with school mathematics, which then has led into my work on a program that I founded in Charlottesville about 9 years ago called MQ, which is called Math, Men, and Mission. So that MQ, M2 is very called. I would love to take credit for that. But for the first 2 years, we called it Math, Men, and Mission, and one of our doctoral students said, well, why not call it MQ? I was like, that's so great. but Math, Men, and Mission has an academic year component as well as a summer component. We focus on mathematics. The idea is that our boys are in grades 3 through 8. And we're very purposeful focusing on that grade band for several reasons. One, in our local area, when we look at kids who have access over in advanced level mathematics, we found that if we start working with them in third grade, perhaps the opportunity to gain access as they move from third grade on to middle school, it will position them well for access to advanced mathematics. Our original goal was to, we have a program called MESA, which is Mathematics, Engineering, and Science Academy. And our original goal was to create a pool of black boys who would be eligible for MESA. The eligibility for MESA is that you would have to take geometry prior to entering high school. And there wasn't a pool of black boys who were eligible. In fact, there was in the 17-year history of the program, there had not been any black boys who were in the MESA program. And so we created this pool for black boys to enter. But now our mission is very different, because now we've had some success, and now we just want to create options for boys. And I say we're focusing on black boys because these boys identify themselves as being black. And I say it in that way because over 60% of our boys are actually biracial. I live in an area where only 4% of the school population are actually black boys. So I live in a predominantly white area. I used to tell folks, and I said this to a group earlier, when my two sons were in elementary school, 25% of the black population at the elementary school lived in my house. So that kind of gives you some scope of that. So I can honestly say in the Charlottesville, Alabama area, I know every black kid, at least from third grade to eighth grade, because they come to us. We've had some success. So that gives you a little bit of background about my research, my service, and then, you know, and then how those things overlap, and my teaching. My teaching, I also teach doctoral seminars on access and equity issues in mathematics education, as well as, you know, the methods courses I teach as well. And so those things overlap significantly purposefully, which then, and I say all of that because that has been my entry to NCTM. I'm highly identified in NCTM, though, that's around issues of access and equity. But I'm still a math guy. I am a math guy. So what I want to do is just talk a little bit about, from the position of president-elect, some of NCTM's work and what we are going to do moving forward, and then invite you. Because this is a great opportunity for me to kind of recruit some folks to get involved into the work of NCTM. Because I, you know, one of the jobs I have is president, like I get to appoint people to committees. And why not take advantage of this opportunity to tap into some, forgive me for saying it this way, but to tap into some new blood. How about that? And old blood is good. Old blood is good, because there's some old blood in here, and who are what we call institutional members and things of that nature. But new blood is good as well. So, here's the point. I'm going to talk a little bit about the High School Task Force, because that's one of our standing committees for NCTM. I'm going to talk about an invitation, how to get involved with the High School Task Force and other committees. And then we're going to unpack some resources for NCTM. And then we're going to spend a little time in Q&A. Questions that you may have, or burning issues that you want to bring up, and things of that sort. All right, so, but first, let me just kind of talk about the board of directors. I'm not the only member of the board that's in this room. We also have another board member in this room, Dan Teague. He's sitting right over there. He's also on the board. And this is Dan's. Dan is what we call a member of the freshman class. And so here's Dan's class right here. And, you know, so, I'm sorry?
The non-nothings.
So this is the new group here. Linda Davenport, Dave Weaver, Dan Hunter, and Dan. And then, of course, next class up. And you can see our board are members of university people, teachers, as well as people who work, so public school, work in public schools in many, in school, K-12 school districts in many ways. And then our senior class, you can see those members as well. And of course, you know, if we go up one more, you can see my goal is to get back to that weight. So that's one of my goals. asked people, people said to me, you don't look like your picture. I was like, okay, thank you. All right, but Matt Larson, Ken Craver, who's our executive director, and myself. So this is the board here. But also, if you're an institute member or will become an institute member very soon, which I hope, you get a chance to vote on the incoming board. And that, this might be my first time in introducing to slate of candidates. And the slate of candidates, if you can go to 2017 board of directors election, and if you can scroll down a little bit. So here's our slate of candidates. Their profiles will be up at the end of this month, October. So somewhere at the end of this month. So we will have, you get to vote on one person to represent the Western region. And you can see our two candidates. And you have three people who will be elected as directors at large. And so I would invite you to come back a little later, probably at the end of this month or beginning of August, if you want to read more about who these people are, and or you know, follow them on Twitter. You might learn a lot as well about who they are and who could be your new representatives on the NCTM Board of Directors. So let's get into the high school task force. So the high school task force was charged. Here's the charge of the high school task force. I'm gonna give you 38 seconds to read this. 38 seconds. Ready, set, and go. So the high school task force is a task force, one of the task force within CTM that is looking at some of the, trying to identify some of the issues or the range of problems in high school mathematics. Not only trying to identify those things, but also come up with, you know, a set of recommendations to address those challenges. Fortunately, Gail is on that task force. So when we get to the Q&A part of this, I'm sure Gail may be able to answer some questions as well. Regarding the task force. The task force came out of the work, if you, let's go to the next slide. So it came out of one of Matt Larson's, our current president, is his president's message. And in that president's message, he had his working title, you know, Pathways Through High School Mathematics, Building Focus and Coherence. And part of that was to address, you know, the purpose of high school mathematics. I was with the group earlier, and I asked them, so what's the goal of high school math? And there was an interesting conversation that came out of that. And I think that's a very interesting thought process. So what is the goal of high school math? Good, you have a show department. I'm gonna, one person, turn to your show department, one person gonna be a talker, one person's going to be the listener. The talker, you're going to talk for 1 minute, and the listener, you're going to listen for 1 minute. All right? And I just want you to talk about what do you think, what in your mind, what's the goal of high school mathematics? Ready? You got a show partner? Everybody got a show partner? Ready? Is that talker? Talk.
Because that's a little flexible and it's something that's still going to transform into a high school.
listener becomes a talker, the talker becomes a listener. Ready, set, talk. Position statement on social justice and mathematics, I'm going to invite you to do that. Just Google it, NCSM position statement on social justice mathematics. I'm gonna invite you to do that because I think that will help frame some of the work that's going on here. These organizations come together collectively. It's every 2 or 3 months. There's a common read. One of the first months was the NCSM position statement. The other was Danny Martin's book and Julia Aguirre's book on identity and mathematics. And there have been discussions around. And so really kind of book discussions and action types of things and some collaboration among the organizations around working together around these issues. It's awareness raising. It is awareness raising. So if you are interested in, so what does social justice look like? In terms of teaching, in terms of curriculum and things of that nature. And I invite you to participate. If you're an NCTM member, you should get the kind of the, for me, it seems like I get them all the time, but these emails with participating in NCTM events, and this is one of those opportunities. So, the task force members, this seems out of order. Cam Graham, who's at the University of New Hampshire, she's the chair. Dan is also, Dan, you should say something. So now Dan could take on a lot of committees, man. Dave Barnes, and then of course we have high school math teachers, high school supervisors, and mathematicians and math educators. And on the next slide, so it shows the full slate of the task force members. Some of these names will look familiar to you. And so it's a pretty diverse group of people, a highly respected group of people that we have. I think we'll bring forth some great recommendations, hopefully. And so part of the goal is to produce, of this high school task force, to produce a document similar to Principles to Action. I'm assuming that many of us are familiar with Principles to Actions. I have the cover there just in case, and I invite you, if you haven't read Principles of Action, to go ahead and grab them, take a look at the document. So it should look very familiar in terms of if you want to kind of face validity in terms of size and things of that nature, it should look like that. It's a plan for follow-up publications, very similar to all of the follow-up publications that's come out of Principles to Actions. And then support documents. Very similar to the Principles to Action Toolkit, which I'll share a little bit later, and of course, institutes and things of that sort. NCTM is going full force on this idea of the high school pathways and on the high school mathematics and what it should look like. Because I've heard in this meeting, discussions around pipelines, discussions around, participation, discussions around access. And this document is gonna hopefully address much of those issues. At least it will provide a framework to begin some discussions. Particularly for those of you who work with administrators who may need some guidance or support, this document should provide those guidance and support. So timeline, so this is the timeline of when the group met. So the first meeting, they met in December, they had a working group meeting. There should be a public review of the first document in fall of 2017. Late fall, you have an opportunity to give feedback. And at the DC meeting is when the actual document should be available. So DC meeting should be an exciting meeting around the work of the high school task force. So you can get involved, as I mentioned earlier. Let's go to the next slide. Well, I skipped over it, but I'm gonna skip that. So some ideas that are consideration for the document. The purpose, some ideas around the purpose of high school mathematics or the high school mathematics curriculum, some ideas around coherence, ideas around identity and agency, some of those issues around barriers in high school mathematics come up. The expectations for 4-year mathematics. What are the expectations of 4 years of mathematics? Some of the essential standards for high school math, and of course, issues around path and different pathways. And so those are some of the ideas that are under consideration in this document. So what can you do? Provide feedback. You know, and I'm going to say this over and over again, provide feedback. And begin to think about the central standards and various pathways that might be implemented. I assume that many of you will have begun to have some of those thinking around these ideas, but really, more feedback feedback that kind of, as I say to my students, just feedback is not enough. It's the kind of feedback that moves the learning forward. It's the kind of feedback that moves the learning forward or moves the issues forward. And so that's the kind of feedback we're looking for. So there are other ways, and so I'm going to step away from the high school task force a little bit and talk about other ways that you can get involved. And so NCTM has standing committees, and you can click on standing committees for me. Troy, I would appreciate that. And so you can get involved in different standing committees. Let's see. Where did it go? So one of my roles as NCTM president, I get to point people to committees. And if you're interested in getting involved in committees, so we have different kinds of committees. We have, of course, we have our journals. Jeremy, MT, Chris is on MT. Let's see, who else is, I'm trying to remember anybody else on any other NCTM committees in here that have. Brian, I don't get Brian. Monica, so, and Brian's also the chair of the San Diego annual meeting. So Brian's gonna put on a great annual meeting in San Diego. And Monica, can you remind me what committee you're on?
CRC.
And so how can you get involved? How can you get involved with annual committees? One of the things that I would invite you to, so if you just click on anyone. Click on Monica's committee. Here we go. So each committee has a charge. And this will help you if you're interested in serving on a committee or nominating someone for a committee. Just take a look at the charge. See if your expertise, your ideas, your resources that you bring or have fits with some of the charge of committees. You can see the members of this of the CRC. And then different members of the committee. Maybe it hasn't been updated yet. Okay, I'll figure that out. So I would invite you to take a look at different standing committees, look at the charge, and see if it fits with your knowledge, resources, and expertise. And if you're interested, then you can shoot me an email. Again, I'm interested in bringing more diverse thinking to the council. In order for that to happen, there's some things I have to consider. I have to consider the geographical balance. I can't have everybody from the East Coast on one committee and everybody on the West Coast. I have to consider, not only geographical balance, also kind of work position balance. Can't have all university people, all teachers. There has to be some balance there, as well as race and gender. Some balance there as well. And so if there's a committee and you weren't appointed, just keep sending me email, because I get to do those for the next 2 years, and have a conversation with me. There's been at least two people who've had a conversation with me since I've been here. I'm open to those conversations as well, because I would be happy to know what kind of resources folks bring and how you might want to get involved. If you shoot me an email, I would prefer that you don't just shoot me an email. I would love to be on CRC. I would love to be on CRC's, you might want to say how you match up to the charge of the committee, what resources you bring, experiences you bring, those kinds of things. And I say that because let's just say someone sends you an email, I want to serve on JRME. But if you've never reviewed for JRME, it would be hard for me to appoint you to JRME. If you've never reviewed for MT, then it would be hard for me to appoint you to MT. So just kind of think about those things. So one of the first entry points might be is to send me an email, how do I become a reviewer for JRME? Or how do I become a reviewer for MT? Rather than serving, you can serve the council in those in that way as well. And then as you gain experience, then you can move into a committee. So just experiences as well. And the same thing can happen, you know, I'm gonna use Brian as an example because I'm just gonna speculate this happened for Brian. And this one, Brian probably served on a regional committee. Then he probably served on some other committee. And then he's gotten appointed to serve as chair of a program committee. So he's done some of the work before he was appointed chair. So some of that work comes into play as well. So I invite you to go to the NCTM website, look at the different standing committees, and just see where you might fit. The only one that's not a fit for, with the exception of a few people in here, would be nominations and elections right now. Unless you've had a significant experience or have been on the board. Let's go back to the PT point. So I think I've said all of those things there. My email is robertberry@virginia.edu. Please, you can send it to my Virginia email. I don't mind at all. I prefer that. Let's go to the next one. So let's look at a couple of resources that NCTM has as well. So if you go to the NCTM homepage, you'll see all of the stuff at the beginning. I just want to talk about a couple of things. If you click on classroom resources, you can see different resources that are available to teachers. You got the ARC, which is Activity with Rigor and Coherence. If you click on that, let's just click on that. And if you just scroll down a little bit, you'll find different activities. Let's just click on one of those activities. Barbie Bungee activity. Again, that might be interesting. So you can see kind of a lesson plan type of format. Some access to resources, vocabulary. So you can see it has a kind of a lesson plan built in terms of doing activity. The intention of the ARCs are just to provide a model for activities that have rigor and coherence. And we talk about coherence in terms of, certainly we're not talking about curricular year-long coherence, but coherence within a series of 3 to 4 lessons. And these activities should be like 3 to 4 lessons when you think about the art. And so that's a resource. If we go back to that, there are other resources you'll find, and we won't just click on classroom resources again. So you'll find all of the kind of other resources. Illuminations, I'm assuming that some of you may have used some of the Illuminations. Resources. Illumination is one thing that NCTM is big on. The other thing that's exciting is the math form. The math form as well. And so that is an exciting resource as well. The NCTM and the math form has come together and the math form resources are available to our members as well. There is a resource, let's go back to the top there. So one of my roles as NCTM president and president-elect is to be an advocate for you and for your local affiliates. And so one of the things, and so I'll give you an example. I had a local affiliate that they were having issues around this idea of homework, where they had this policy that was put into play about no homework at the district level policy. policy, no homework. And so the local affiliate got in contact with us and asked this question. So what's the institute's position on homework? And what, so what does the research say about homework and things of that sort? Fortunately, that was one of the easier ones in terms of policy, because we actually have a position paper on homework. We also have some advocacy work around homework. So if you go to research and advocacy, you can go to research briefs and clips. And let's see, there should be, so you can see, rather than, so you can see some of the research briefs the institute has put forward, the benefits of discussion, the benefit of formative assessment. And the benefit of formative assessment is a really good one. Dylan Williams wrote that. If you're familiar with Dylan Williams' work, you know, he's the expert in formative assessment. There should be a research brief on homework somewhere down here. There we go, homework history, what research says about homework, those kinds of things. And so, those kinds of things. And we also have some of our policy statements around these issues as well. And so, you know, if you ever have a question, you know, you can email myself, you can email Matt and say, you know, our division is thinking about this. Because that's part of our role as president of NCTM, is to have an advocacy position to support our members. You know, what are some of the resources out there? If we can get our hands on them, we can share them with you. If not, we may be able to get our hands on an expert who may be able to help us help you. And the last thing I want to talk about, or one of the last things I want to talk about, is you can go to conferences and professional development. And if you go to professional development resources, so, and let's just go, so I'm going to share with you the professional development. I don't know if you're familiar with the Principles and Actions Toolkit. If you click on Principles Actions Toolkit, because this is one I'm excited about. So for those of you who are teacher leaders and you want to work with maybe your grade level team or someone in a group of teachers in your school division, if in Principles and Actions we had the 8 effective teaching practices. And you can see those 8 effective teaching practices across the top. It's that right there, thank you. And so you see elementary, and if you go down, let's just go down to high school. And so, for example, if you click on S patterns, and all of them are set up very similar in this way. And so you can see there are videos, there are classroom videos for each of those, and there are a few of them where there are cases, there are case studies where you read them. The nice thing is, in this toolkit, there's PowerPoint slides there. So if you click on a slide or a set of PowerPoints that you can then go in and edit and fit to your needs to use the videos to go with them. There's transcripts of the video clips. There's all the resources for you to just kind of pick up and do a PD on. And that was the intention of this. That was the intention of this work for Toolkit. This still is under construction because I have one I have not finished yet. So I know it's still under construction. But you can get a sense of the resources for you as teacher leaders, or for you as teachers just kind of want to look. I use it, and sometimes I use video clips in different ways. Like this clip I use for access and equity. Although this set of materials is about supporting productive struggle, I use it for access and equity and talk about positionality, how to teach a position to students as being competent in mathematics, and not only positionality from position of agency and agency and identity and agency, but also positionality in terms of proximity. Let's go back up to the top. Grants and awards, and There are travel grants, grant opportunities to come to the annual meeting, and other special opportunities as well. I'm gonna stop there and invite you to ask questions, and if there's something that you wanna ask me about that maybe I can point towards you on going to on the NCTM website. Ms. Mayor.
Can you explain to my...
Will you please explain to the group why you use the term black boys?
So my research, I use the term black boys. I used to use African American, and I used to use African, I used to use the term male. But now I use the term black boys because I'm intentional. The term boy imparts vulnerability. It imparts someone in need of support. It puts black boys in a developmental space. And when I'm writing about middle school boys, I want them to be perceived in a developmental space. I do get pushback on using the term black and boy together because of the historical connotation that is associated with it. But I use it intentionally to say, well, black boys, vulnerability, in need of support, in need of mentoring, and it's developmentally appropriate. And oftentimes when you look in the public context, black boys often perceived to be older than what their actions are. And I talked about this with the case of Tamir Rice. He was only 12 years old, but he was perceived as being much older than being 12 years old. So I talk about that in my writing, and I often raise the question about, does it happen in schools that, you know, are black boys not put in a developmental space when they behave in certain ways? They're still children. And we have to treat them as children. And if you look at the research on discipline, I'm not convinced that they're being treated as children. You asked that question. Any other question? Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is David Martin. I work in Gross Point, Michigan at Salah High School.
Michigan.
Thank you, Monica. And our school is a predominantly white community. We have a subset of students who are African American, and we struggle with them as being a little, what I would say, underrepresented in some of your more rigorous math courses. What is the one piece of advice you could give me to take back to my district to say, here's one way we could improve. Here's one thing we can do right now. Here's one thing we can do just to kind of get the ball rolling.
So I don't know if I can give you one piece of advice. I think there are systems and things that can be done. I would argue that my community probably is not that much different from your community in terms of demographics. My community is changing. And in fact, the Latinx students are proportionally, there are more Latinx students than there are black students. And I use Latinx as a proxy for Latino Latinx. And I would say this, can we get the annual perspective on 2018, humanizing mathematics, and we could unpack that in terms of why Latinx. One of the things that we did not, one of the pushback that we got, so why do you have a program called the Black Boys? So one of the things that we did, we tried to create a cohort of boys to get into Mesa. One of the things that probably, one of the issues that we ran into was that we ran into a teacher population that was not ready for this cohort of boys. we had to do some training on teachers in terms of, and people use the term culturally relevant, culturally responsive. And I like to use, I like to refer to just kind of thinking about issues of how do we understand the resources that children bring from communities that are different from their teachers. And once we understand those resources, then how do we take advantage of those resources? So one thing we had to do is get the teachers to know the resources that these kids bring. And so what we did with some of our teachers, we did community visits, and some of the things you probably can guess and probably some people already do. But we then unpack that in such a way that I'm sitting in a space where I'm talking with white women about black communities. And in my contact, that was the situation. And just my role was I was able to serve as a critical friend for some of the teachers. And I'll give you an example of one teacher. She came to me and said, "What's the deal with the hair thing?" And that's how she said it. And it was genuine, because she wanted to know what's the hair. I mean, and she didn't have anybody to ask about the black community and their hair. And so that was the resource I served to her. And talk about why hair, you know, is important, and to show pride, provide her the resources. And she asked me questions that, you know, that if we weren't friends, it could be perceived differently. How are my black kids so loud? And she asked. And I appreciated that. And so for me, I serve as a resource in a role where she can be as vulnerable as she wanted to be and as honest as she could be. And I can be as honest as I could be with her. And we were cool with that. I don't know. I mean, so one of the things, when I say I don't know, it is that conversation that kind of bring down barriers. It is that conversation where we begin to look at the resources. And so, and I say that because she's stuck on the loudness of the talk and not the talk itself. She's stuck on I use the term, you're stuck on the swagger and not the the depth. You know, those kinds of things. And so, you know, perhaps it may be someone who's critical and vulnerable enough to have this kind of conversations. I wish I could say more. I mean, but I think there are a lot of things that we put in place to have to create these things. You know, and so one, I often get asked this question, so what's that got to do with math? In the same way that these kids are not getting access to the mathematics, and it has everything to do with math in terms of participation. You know, so I often say to them, how can we create opportunities? So if we think of some of my Wednesday talk, if we think of participation from a child's perspective as a risk-taking event, so they're in front of their peers, they have to share their thinking. Those are the kinds of things that we want to happen in math classroom, right? We want to share their thinking, things that sort. If you think of participation as a risk-taking event, what are the structures in place that kids are willing to take a risk in your classroom? And if you can't think of any structures that are in place, that you have in place right now, where kids are willing to take a risk, then that's something that we need to go back and discuss and investigate. So, how do we create high participation and low risk environments? So that's my talk on Wednesday. So you might I'll talk about the fact that won't work. And talk about how we can do that, or how we've been able to do that. Questions? So my methods class, I always say to my students, one of the things that we said in terms of research participation, as questions, comments, or compliments. Everybody has either a question, a compliment, a comment, or you can offer a compliment. Questions, comment, or compliment?
interested in mathematics.
How did I get interested in that? So I would say I was a good math student when I was younger. And I, when I say good, good defined in a very traditional sense. I learned my multiplication table for everyone else. I got the six stars on the little sign there, and this and that and the other. I had that kind of efficacious experience. I told you earlier how I came into math teaching. So my first undergraduate career was in civil engineering. I worked as a civil engineer for 8 months. I hated that job. And the reason why I hated the job, it may have been contextual factors. I worked on a project for the Virginia Department of Transportation where I was a project, I was a project director, project manager. But there were men who worked with me on that project who were old enough to be my father and my grandfather. But I was a supervisor. I was 22 years old with no leadership skills. The only difference between them and me, well, there were a lot of differences between them and me, but I was the boss and they weren't. That difference is whether I had a degree or they didn't. But they had everything much more than what my degree had to offer. Benefit of experience. Some of them have more experience in the job than I've been living, longer than I've been living at the time. But I was their boss. Now that I'm older and can reflect on it, I would have probably treated me the way I was treated. Because I was a 22-year-old trying to act like a boss. And I hated that job. So I ended up going back and I quit the job in April. I can remember it was April, my birthday month, and I remember all the context of that. I went back to my undergraduate institution and said, okay, what degree can I get now with all these courses? I wasn't too far away from finishing, a degree in middle school education with a focus on math and science. I'm like, cool, I can do that. and I did that, and I became a middle school teacher. I absolutely love teaching. I probably would have never left teaching had I not had a master's advisor who thought I should get a PhD. I love teaching that much, and I still do. I love teaching my methods courses. I love teaching. I teach in the summer program that I design. I teach in that program every summer. Except for this summer. This first summer I wasn't able to do it because I got a new job. I entered. I don't know if I say I love that. And that's hard to say in this room. And kind of, and I say, why? The reason why I won't say I love math is that because now I'm in this space where I'm critical and I'm in this social anthropological space, and I think about what math can cannot do, how math has been used to injure people. And am I a part of the system that injures people? I hope I'm not, and I'm trying to dismantle that. But math has been used to injure people. And I don't want to be a part of a system that injures people. So I thought we were talking about it detail, any other questions?
Anybody have any other questions? Comments, ooh, compliments, thoughts.
I already have a question. That last point resonated. What do you mean math interests people? Can you elaborate on that?
She wants Robert to elaborate on math injuring people.
So
kids who, not kids, but people who kind of deny opportunities because from math performance. I think about how data and statistics are used in various different ways. I think about barriers that are put in place. So there's structural, and then there's the content of mathematics. I think about, I would love for every kid to have the kind of those aha moments, and I'm sure it just doesn't seem to all kids have those kinds of moments. They're having this repetitive same experience over and over and over and over again. I think about how some school divisions, and we have a local school division that has Algebra 1A, Algebra 1B, Algebra 1AB, then Algebra 1ABC. I mean, you take Algebra 3, you take Algebra 8. So to me, that's kind of I do think about how math is, and how kids are blamed for some of their experiences and when structures in place for that. I just think about structural, institutional stuff that are put in play. Even in my own experience, I think about, I should not have gotten to graduate school if you're going to use my GRE scores. I should not have been there. And luckily, I had some advocates in place for me. My performance, so using my GRE scores, my GRE scores didn't represent what I was capable of doing. And I think how testing has now been used to injure kids in the way, and where our advocates to come to school with us.
I think that's a really important point.
And
I think it's not the math per se, it's what we do with the math and how we interpret the results. And I'll just add one little incident that I had. So a lot of the colleagues I work with like to have their kids engage, especially in elementary school, in time tests for their times tables. And that, I've had a discussion with people about, well, what about the kid who's always last? What if he can do almost all of them perfectly, but he only gets through the first half? But he's got them all right, yet he's being spotted out because he's not quite as fast. And so he's being fast. So it's not the math, it's what we do with it. It's okay to learn your time series, but it's perfectly okay to take a little bit longer to do them than to take someone else. And sometimes we don't acknowledge that.
But also there's another acknowledgement of the history of mathematics. And oftentimes when I talk to my boys when they're in the cube, and I think, you know what? You have a legacy of mathematics. And you look at African civilizations that built some of our mathematics. And then this is some of the legacy that you have to aspire to. It's just some note. And so that's part of my role, my job as a teacher and as a mentor. But I'm also, it's also interesting how they get to a certain stage or age and they just don't know how they get to it. It's the feeling that I guess when you think about Hidden Figures, and a lot of people have seen Hidden Figures and the feeling that people have about Hidden Figures and things of that nature and what's come out of it. And the thing I love about Hidden Figures, that's my hometown. I grew up in Hampton, Virginia. And I know Miss Catherine Johnson. In church we call her Miss Catherine. And so it is that. And it's funny because when I mentioned Miss Catherine, I didn't know she did that. was just a church lady. I mean, we knew she worked at NASA. I mean, we knew she worked there, but we didn't know that she was Miss NASA. I mean, but it's those stories that stay hidden.